Good morning, everybody. Happy Sunday. God is good. Amen. Who is glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. Church, we ask that you get to your feet with us today. And like every Sunday, we want to invite you to help us fill the house of the Lord with prayer.
Thank you, Lord, for another day in your house, God. We thank you for this blessing to be able to come freely to your house and to praise your name and to just glorify you, God. And we ask that today that you would just fill our hearts, that you would fill our hearts with your presence, with your love, with all that you are, that you would continue to mold us, Lord, every day of our lives. We ask that you would allow us to have a beautiful service and that you would receive our worship in Jesus' name. Amen.
All honor to God. Amen. Church, this morning I wanted to share with you Romans 8:37-39. And Romans 8 starts, "No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Amen. There is absolutely nothing that can separate us from the love of God, church. And this morning, I encourage you to hold on to him. Hold on to him and be sensitive and be aware to where he is. He's with us everywhere all the time. Amen. God is so good to us. He never lets us go. This morning, church, we invite you to praise his name, to give him all the worshiping your holy name. Oh God, I'm so grateful, Lord, for all of your goodness and your love, Lord. This morning, I'm just so grateful, Lord, that even through the trials, the storms, God, you are there with us. You're there with us. You uphold us, God. You uphold us. And this morning, Lord, we just come to worship you, Lord, as one church united, Heavenly Father, as your children.
Rising fire.
are so grateful that we get to come to your house to worship your name, God. We get to worship you in your entirety, Lord. You have been so good to us. You've never let us go, God, and we are here ready and prepared, Lord, to continue to worship and continue to walk in faith in your name. God, we are ready, Lord, to go out there with in full faith, Lord, declaring and proclaiming your goodness out to the world, Heavenly Father. All creature, Heavenly Father, will praise you, will worship you. And today, as your children, Lord, we come before you with humble and open hearts to receive what it is you have for us. God, we praise you this morning. Amen.
thank you so much for everything that you've done for us. Thank you for bringing us together in fellowship, God. Today we ask that for a special blessing, a special anointing, and opening of the hearts of everybody here. We ask that you allow us to have a perfect service. Speak through all the teachers, speak through everyone that's going to be teaching today. God, we love you, and amen.
Sorry, guys, I'm not like Pastor, so let's see if we get the lights on.
I'm kind of like Pastor. I'm half a little Pastor.
All right, guys, let's see, you're testing. Can you hear me out there?
Perfect,
you guys. It's good to have you guys. Give me a few minutes. Let me just get down real quick. How are you guys doing this morning? Oh, that sounds miserable. How are you guys doing this morning?
Good.
All right, that's a little bit better. You guys pretending like it's not football season, like you're not excited, like you don't have things to do. Guys, we're super happy to have you this morning. Go ahead and shake each other's hands while we get everybody going, and then we'll start in just a minute, okay? So go ahead and give each other a good hello, good handshake, good hi. And you may be seated whenever you like, guys. I'm still new to this, I'm sorry. Guys, it's so good to have you this Sunday morning. It's a pleasure to be able to preach to you guys. Pastor's going to be in New Mexico. He's had the privilege to go ahead and speak for one of his students who's having his anniversary as a pastor. Right? I mean, Pastor's been around for a long time, right? He gets to go and see the fruits of his labor. He gets to go be a part of something special in New Mexico. So we're going to be taking over today. We're really excited to have you guys. We'll call it a collision takeover, I guess, because you guys get to see firsthand what we teach to the kids. And you're going to see that we hold the kids just as accountable as Pastor holds you guys, right? The message is still the same. The God is still the same. But we're still going to be teaching exactly what we teach the kids. You guys are going to get. And I want you guys to be able to see what we do, what we teach, how we run things. That way we bring more kids, guys. We bring more youth. We start bringing kids in from school, start bringing kids in. I mean, we're working as hard as we can to get kids from schools here. And vice versa, us getting into schools. We've already done it twice this year. I'm already working. I work at a school now. I'm going to be working and trying to get us plugged in there. I mean, that's what we want to do. But it starts here. Yeah. Right? It starts with the church. It starts with building a church that God wants to be a part of. Does that make sense? Amen. Because you can build a church and not have it filled with the Word of God and not have it filled with what it needs to be, then it's not a church. It ain't nothing. It's just a group of people. We just a population. We just a group of friends that hang out and believe half of what the Bible says. And that's not what we need to do. So today we're going to be teaching on building the church. Kids, if you've gone to class or you've been listening, we're going to be going over a class that we've already done before, but we're changing it up a bit so you're not going to get bored. It's going to be good. Okay? We're going to be talking about building the church. It's not going to be a super long sermon. Bobby, you're probably going to miss the Cowboy game though, okay? I'm sorry. You're going to miss the first time. There you go. We're on a time schedule. But the first thing I want to remind you guys is, I know a few weeks ago, maybe about a month ago, Pastor talked about tithing. How many of you guys love tithing? We love tithing, guys, right? But I want to talk to you guys about something other than tithing. I want to talk to you guys about what it means to almost give like a donation. Give your time, give your effort. Does that make sense? Because that's not the same as tithing. Tithing is not going out of your way. Tithing is expected. Right? That's not, God didn't say, well, I hope you can do it, or, hey, brother, when you get a chance, go ahead and give it. Like God says, you're going to give your 10% because when I give you 100, all I want back is 10. Okay? So we're not going to be talking about tithing because tithing is expected. And I don't like to talk about tithing. No, I don't like to talk about other people's money, right? That's Pastor's job. Today we're going to talk about something a little bit different. And like I tell you guys, with the youth, I let them answer, I let them talk. Jake's a little bit different. I know Pastor usually goes, so if I ask you a question, someone answer. And be loud because this microphone's pointing at me, right? This one on the camera. So I'm going to ask a question. And Victoria asked it to the kids about 2 weeks ago. And so how or what can we do to give back to the one who created the heavens and the earth? So what can we do to give back to God? Does anybody got anything that they can say? How can you give back to God? Win souls, going out and preaching the gospel. How else can you give back to God? I don't want to hear tithing, right? Serving. See, those two answers are exactly what I needed to hear. Winning souls and serving. You win souls by serving. You win souls by going out of your way to do what God has asked you to do. Okay? Now, here's the biggest time thing, God. Guys, I want you guys to understand that we can give more than just money. Right? There's a very big misconception that, you know, well, all we want is your money. All we need is your finances. And that's not true. Right? If you look it up here, I mean, none of us get paid. None of the teachers get paid. We do things because we want to. Because we're thankful for what God has done in our life. Right? That's why we do it. So, guys, I want you to understand that you can give your time. And God loves that. You can give your resources and your skills, and God loves that. Okay? I want you guys to understand something like cleaning the church, God loves that. He sees that. Maybe you can't play the guitar. Maybe you can't play the piano. Maybe you can't sing, but you can pick up a mop. You can pick up a broom. That's something. That's a skill. Not everyone can clean like everybody. I promise you, I can't clean as well as some of you guys can. My mom can say that quite honestly, right? Like, I can't clean the same way some of you guys can. I can't cook the same way some of you guys can. And those are skills. Those are things that you can do to help build the church from the inside out, right? You listen to the song From the Inside Out. It talks about, you know, starting with you from the inside out. Well, I'm assuming now that you've already been working on that. So now it's time to build the church from the inside out. Because we can't start reaching out until we've built the church from inside. We can't start inviting people in until we're set up to start teaching. Until we're set up and we got things going 100 miles an hour. Why? Because if we mess up, then they're gone. If we teach them wrong, then it's on us. We need to be prepared. We need to have the church ready for everything. For each and every circumstance. And how do we do that? It's not just with pastor. It's not just with the leaders. It starts with every single person in the church. Because each and every single one of you are the church. You are the temple. God lives in you. Each and every one of you has the expectation to share God's word. Not just pastor, not just the leaders. Each and every single one of you. So we're going to be talking about building the church from the inside out. Okay, that's one of the most important things that a lot of people skip that process. A lot of people go buy a big building, and they'll go hire a bunch of people, and they'll hire the best singers, but they never built it from the inside out. They built it from the outside in. And that's an issue. That's where we start turning people away. That's when we start turning away from God's word. That's when we start teaching things that sound nice instead of things that will actually change your life. Those are issues that we're coming across right now, and we're going to change that. And that hasn't happened here. But we see it constantly in so many different churches, in so many different cities, in so many all across the nation, and it needs to change. We need to build the church from the inside out. Okay? So, how many of you guys have ever heard pastors say, please stop helping. We've covered everything and we don't need any more help? Never, right? Not once has pastors said, bro, please stop because you're giving too much. 25 years, never heard it. Mr. Davis, how many years have you been here? 50 years. Your dad's been here 50, sorry. Have you ever heard him say that? Never, never. Cortez, you've been here since you've been born. Have you ever heard pastor say, please stop giving? Never. Pastor has never sat here and said, guys, you've given so much that you can stop now. Never. Not a single circumstance, whether it was for an event, whether it was for church itself, cleaning, ministries. Pastor's always saying, you know, we need more. We need to be able to push more. We need to do this. Well, I'm going to talk to you guys about one of the very few times in the Bible that a pastor had to sit there and say, that's it, you've done enough. You've given too much. We need to stop. I can't do anymore with it. I've run out of things to do with it. Okay? So, we're going to jump into the book of Exodus. We're going to be paraphrasing everything, guys. Chapter 35 through 40, we're going to be talking about the tabernacle. Now, I don't know if Pastor's gone over it a lot here recently. I know we talked about it a few weeks ago. Cortez did a very awesome overview. If you listen to your class, she even showed you pictures of how it was built. But we're going to be talking about the building of the tabernacle, okay? And this specific event takes place right after the Israelites fled from Egypt, okay? They've already seen God's greatness. They've seen all the crazy things that he can do. They saw the plagues. They've seen the locusts. They've seen the frogs. I mean, they were witness to see all the things that God had done in their favor to get them out of enslavement. They got to see all of that. Okay? And something I was to acknowledge within this story is that they're in the desert. They're in the middle of nowhere. They're on their way to the promised land, right? They're following Moses. They're in the desert. You know what? Things aren't that great, but God is still providing, right? He gives them manna. He gives them quail. Gives them shade to make sure they're not baking in the sun. Gives them everything that they need. It may not be everything that they want, but God gives them everything that they need, and they've seen that time and time and time again. It's something that they acknowledge. Now they do, I mean, we talked about in the youth that we talked about Leviticus because, you know, they were having their own problems, so they have to set a guideline, but they were still witness to seeing everything that great things that God has done. Now, who's had blessings in their life? Who's been a witness of great things that God has done? All right, good. So now you can relate. You don't get everything that you want, but you get everything that you need. Amen? Amen? Amen. Let's hear it one more time. Amen?
Amen?
There it is. Now we're talking. Now we're in church. So I want you guys to understand the way their lifestyle was in this moment. They were nomads, guys. They didn't have houses. They didn't have two-story houses. Everything that they had at this time is what they carried on their back. They had to carry whatever they had from Egypt to the promised land. So they were constantly moving. Right, because their plan isn't to stay in the desert. That was our plan, right? We decided to stay in El Paso. We chose to stay in the desert. But their plan was, we're going to the land of milk and honey. We're going to the promised land. So these guys are nomads, okay? They lived in tents, then traveled when God said it was time to travel. So if God said, hey, that's it, it's done, they stop. We see that in the book of Leviticus. They stay at Mount Sinai for a long time, for a whole book, okay? And just a side note, if you guys don't know how God manifested himself for the people to be able to view him, during the day, it was a massive cloud, right? That way they wouldn't be burned up by the sun, and at night, a ball of fire. Now, in my mind, that's crazy. That's so awesome. Like, he thought about the little things, right? Like, I know it's hot. I know it's miserable out here, but let me give you a little something to help you out. I know it's dark, and I know it's hard to see. Let me be a ball of fire so you can't miss me. God has been there since the very beginning, okay? Now, aside from that, as they were going, God wanted them to create a place where individuals could worship in a place dedicated to him. What do we call that now, guys? Church. That's a church, right? So they were building a church. They were building a place to worship. They were building an area in which God can fill. Okay? Now, a tabernacle, the specific word is tabernacle, translates to a tent, or a dwelling place. For the first, God wanted a place where he could dwell with his people. Where he could be side by side with his people. Okay? Now that's something, again, a big misconception of the Old Testament is that God was a, you know, hellfire and brimstone and he didn't care. But God is saying right here, guys, I just want you guys to make a place that I can be, so I can be right next to you guys. This is relevant because back before this, the only time this happened was back in Adam and Eve, back in Genesis. That was the first time that God was able to be right next to his people. And until then, there was always that gap, right? He was still able to answer prayers. He was still there. He was still watching over. He was still taking care. But he couldn't be like right there. And God wants a dwelling place where God's here and just a few feet away, his people are there. Just right outside, his people are worshiping. Right? Because Jesus hasn't happened yet. So we can't be right up with God because then we would die. We're not perfect. Okay? And what's going to happen is, NFL, right? God wanted to be great. He wanted it to be immaculate. God doesn't settle for half the effort, right? He never asked you for half of your time. He never asked you for half the effort. So God wanted something that was going to be beautiful for his tabernacle. And he said he wanted the most beautiful linens, the most beautiful jewels, gold, and resources at the time. Now, they're in the desert. There's nowhere to buy these things. You can't go buy gold. You can't go buy linens. As it is, they're refugees. People don't really want them, right? They're God's people. So they only have what they could carry. So where are they going to get these things, guys? Somebody answer. Where are they going to get it from? Themselves. It's whatever they had. Understand that. Whatever they had is all that they could give. They couldn't go to the market to buy, you know, diamond rings. They couldn't go to the market to buy linens. They had to give what they had, and what they had was minimal. What they had is what they could carry with them from Egypt while they were running. As it is, I'm sure they threw stuff on like, oh, now they're chasing us, trying to kill us. Too heavy, we're leaving the nice stuff. So all they had is probably what they valued the most. things that were passed down from generation to generation. Jewels, gold, rings, necklaces, linens. Remember back, now we talk about like, you know, cotton and stuff. Back in the day, linens were a legit thing. If you had really nice clothes, you were the bomb, right? You were the guy, you were the person. And Moses told the people that God had asked them to do, to give offerings willingly from the heart to make the tabernacle. And people with special talents would have to work very hard to build a tabernacle, because this is what I want you guys to understand, right? There's some people that were probably like, I don't have anything, so I don't got to do anything, right? I know that's something like that was me, right, when I didn't have a job in pastor. It was like, okay, we're going to go ahead and start tithing. And I was like, I don't have any money, so I can't do anything. You know what I'm saying? Or sometimes you find yourself where it's like, you see the kids on stage, we're getting ready for worship under the stars, and you're like, well, I can't sing, so I guess I can't do anything. And God sits here and says, no, your special talents are going to be what gets this going. Okay? The Lord did not want people to buy the things from the temple. He wanted them to give all the items. And God wanted the people to show their love for him by giving their own things. He also wanted the people to work for free in building the temple. So, what's going on, guys? God's saying, I want a temple. He's saying, I want you to give the best that you have willingly. I don't want you to get upset about it. I don't want you to be mad about it. I want you to give it to me because you love me. I want you to give it to me because of everything that I've already done for you. Build a place that we can spend time together. God's not saying, it's not just for me. He said, let's build a place that we can spend time together. I've given you my 100%. Are you willing to give me yours? Okay? Now, one of the biggest things that I want you to understand about building a church from the inside out is the fact that, I get it, not everybody has money. Not everybody is blessed in that manner. But people are blessed in a lot of different ways. Some people are blessed at playing music. Some people are blessed at being cooks. Some people are blessed at being able to fix holes in the wall. I can't do that. Right? I've had the privilege to be able to see people work in the background where others don't. I see when the band works. Yeah, maybe they don't have all the money in the world, but they give their voices. They give their guitar playing skills. They give their bass playing skills, their drum skills. I've seen when we practice, I've seen the Cortezes and Sisterinas come make this to make the altar look prettier. I've seen them go out of the way to make this. I've seen hermanas and hermanos come in to clean the church when nobody's looking. Those things matter. That's what builds a church from the inside out. It's not about the money. It's not about how big the building is. It's about how great the people are within. It's about the God that's within and the people that are filled with God from within. That's where it starts. That's what we need to be doing. Understand, it doesn't have to be money. You can give to God by giving your resources, your skills, your time. Don't think because I don't have money that I'm not blessed in that manner that you can't help. Each and every single one of you has something special that you can offer. I know there are people in here that are holding back because it's inconvenient, because it's hard. God needs each and every single one of you. He doesn't just need Jake. He doesn't just need Becca in the children's ministry. He doesn't just need Don in the worship ministry. He needs each and every single one of you, because people that I cannot reach, you can. But it starts with you, right? You have to want to. And that's what he's telling the people. You have to want to give. Because if you don't want to willingly give your time, if you don't want to willingly give your effort, if you only want to do it because you're getting paid, then you're doing it for the wrong reason. Amen. Right? That's supposed to be Christianity 101, but it seems like we forget that. Oh, because it's inconvenient. Nah, I don't want to help out with church here. Nah, I'm a little too busy. It's going to be a little too hard. Nah, I don't want to show up to church. Like, that's Christianity 101. That's supposed to be what we believe in. Well, we've kind of strayed away from making God the priority and making our lives our priority. And we can't do that. Right? And I'm not saying you don't matter, but when the great one, when the great I am says, I need you to start working, and we choose not to, there's an issue. And the moment you stepped into church, I promise you, said, it's time to start working. It's time to start doing your part. You chose to be part, you chose to want to join, you chose to want to be in this family, then you're going to pull your weight. You have to. Now, we continue on, right? It says, He also wanted the people to work for free in the building of the temple. I mean, that's basic, right? I mean, you see that now. Who would here would go out and do your job for free? Yeah, I wouldn't. I love my job now. I got a new job, but I wouldn't do it for free. And God's saying, I want you to put in this hard work for free. I want you to do it for free. I want you to go out of your way. Okay? And even if they did not have anything to give, they could still help with the work. Something that I feel like is overshadowed by all the pretty things are, like, for the individuals that are down to come and stay and pick up chairs to help pastor so he doesn't have to do it. That matters. Right? Work. Our God is not a lazy God. Our God works. Right? So if our God is not a lazy God, we can't be lazy. We can't sit there and say, I don't want to because I'm tired, or I don't want to because it's inconvenient. Be a part. All right, God sees that. I want you guys to understand that. Like, the eyes that he sees the praise and worship team, and the eyes that he sees pastor with are the same eyes that he sees you with. Amen. And he sees everything. Not one thing is more important than the other. He's saying, you took the time to be a part. You took the time to help. Then guess what? You're doing your job. I'm not asking you to go out of your way. I'm telling you, do things that you're great at for God. Imagine if all the best singers in the world did it for God. That would be amazing. But we don't. They don't. It is what it is. Okay? Now, I'm going to ask this question, and you already know the answer to it, so I better hear an answer. How much do you think they gave? Hector, I love you. Answer me, boy. Get me. Tell me. How much do you think they gave, Hector? 100%. They gave too much. They gave too much. Where Moses is like, we've already built it. We already got so much gold and we got so much jewels and the linens are perfect. There's so much. Just stop giving. Because I can't do any more with it. And what does that mean? It wasn't just the jewels, the gold. It was just also the individuals coming. Okay, you need me to mount the gold for you? I got you. Because it's not that easy to just, oh, we're just going to get gold and put it on some paper. Like, it doesn't work like that. They didn't have duct tape back then. They didn't have flex seal. You had to actually have a skill, have a trade. So the thing wasn't just like, hey, stop giving. It was like, hey, you've already given so much of your time, your effort, your resources, that the job is complete. And you didn't have to beg people. And I sat here and I'm like, well, why didn't he have to beg people? And I'm like, okay, well, maybe because they saw the frogs and they saw the locusts and they saw all these crazy things that God did. They saw him part the Red Sea. And I mean, what about now? And I'm like, well, dang, God's still done great things in my life, right? Amen. So why do we have to beg? Why do I have to convince myself that this is what I want to do? God has done so many great things in our lives that we've seen God do great things in other people's lives, but we're still trying to convince ourselves if this is something we want to be a part of. We're still trying to convince ourselves, is this something that I want to put my time and effort to? Why is that a question? It shouldn't be a question. If he gave you his 100%, you should give your 100%. There is no excuse that, well, it's because they got to see all the crazy things. I've seen a lot of crazy things. I've seen people not die. I've seen people be healed. I've seen miracles happen. I've seen it with my own eyes. So I know you have too. If you've been part of this church, you've seen crazy things happen. There's no excuse to have to beg a church to move forward if they truly believe in God. Because if you truly believe in God, then you know that he is all-powerful, almighty, and deserves every ounce of respect, honor, resource, skill, talent that we have. Amen. That's who our God is. If you truly believe that, then that's what you got to believe. Either you give him your 100, or he wasted his time. You have to. Don't waste his time. Don't be that person. I go to church, but I don't do anything at church. You don't do anything, man. You know, one of the best examples that I have, I know I pick on Hector a lot, right? Because I love this man with all my heart. When Hector couldn't walk, and I want you guys to know this, right? Because this is something that he did because he wanted to, right? When Hector couldn't walk, he said, I still want to do something for Worship Under the Stars. I still want to help. You know what he did? He just made sure no one would pass the gate for me. He couldn't walk. He couldn't do anything. We gave him an umbrella because we felt bad because he was turning red. We gave him waters. Like, guys, God cares about those things. That's still working. That's still going out of the way. That's giving your time. That's giving your resource. That stuff matters. Don't think it doesn't matter. God sees everything that you do, and he sees it with the heart that you do it with. Don't think because you don't have money, because you don't got a pretty voice, because you can't play the guitar, because maybe you can't preach. Don't think that because you can't do those things that you can't be part of the family, that you can't be a working member of this group. There are so many things in this church that need to get done. But there's so many people that don't want to do the work. Okay. Now we saw an example of what it looks like when the church comes together and gets things done. The pastor had to say, no more. It's done. We finished. Imagine the joy that came when God saw that they did it, when it was done. That's amazing. That's what we work for, right? That we go through life to make it to heaven. For him to say, well done. And to do that here, so that hopefully others can see the greatness of our God. And for God to be happy with that, how awesome should that be? How awesome must that feel to do what they did? If you've been part of this church, you've done it at least 10 times. You guys have seen crazy things that we do when the church comes together as one and works. Okay. Now we're going to start jumping into scripture that correlates directly with this. We have Deuteronomy 16:16-17. It says, no man should appear before the Lord empty-handed. Each of you must bring a gift in proportion to the way the Lord your God has blessed you. So we're going to be talking about, remember I told you, not everyone is blessed with money. That's just a fact of life, right? Not everyone is blessed with a voice. Not everyone was blessed with certain skills. But God has blessed you nonetheless with something. Each and every single one of you has been blessed one way or another. In Deuteronomy, they said, don't come to God and say, I have nothing to offer. However he's blessed your life, take that blessing and use it for the kingdom of God. That's what that's saying, Deuteronomy 16:16-17. Don't come to me and say that you don't have anything to give, because that's saying I've never blessed you a day of your life. So I get it. Not only, but guess what? If you got a voice, you can speak the gospel. You don't got to preach it, just speak it. If you got skills, maybe you know how to do maintenance, you can help out. If you got money, maybe you can give money. If you can sing, maybe you can sing. If you just got a good work ethic, maybe you're welcome to come in and help us and tear things down, build things up. Don't say that you have nothing to offer when God says, I've blessed you every single day of your life. There's no reason why you can't help out. Yeah. And that's from God. That's Deuteronomy, right? So if you've been blessed, let me hear an amen. A little bit louder, because I think blessings are the best thing that God's ever given us aside from grace and mercy. So how many of you have been blessed?
Amen.
There you go. Now we're in church, right? So if you've been blessed, I want you guys to raise your hand and say amen on the count of three. Because I want you guys to be proud of the blessings that you've received. I want you to say, I've gotten a blessing, okay? So on the count of three, who's been blessed? One, two, three.
Amen.
Everybody raise their hand. Everyone's been blessed. So if everyone's been blessed, then everyone can help in one way or another. Everyone can be a part one way or another. Be proud of your blessings. Show them off. Now, don't be mean about it. But show it off. Show people what God has done for you. And show them how what he's done for you can help them. How what he's done for you translates to the real world. How God can also bless them. Right? Show people that money ain't everything. Some people are blessed with joy. Some people are blessed with the fact that they're not depressed and they're not sad and they're not angry. Like, that matters. Not everybody has that. If we have money, share some of that blessing, okay? We don't all have that blessing, alright? But be proud of everything that God has given you. Each and every single person in this room has been blessed, and he has been faithful in all of our lives. Every single person here, God has been faithful in your life. Maybe things haven't gone the way you thought they would. Maybe life is a little harder now, but you're still alive.
Amen.
You still got another day, either to make it right or to help a family member or to help a friend that you know doesn't got it right. I mean, you got a breath of life. That's a blessing in itself, because not everybody gets that. Every day you wake up is a blessing. Every day you take a breath is a blessing. Please don't think that blessings only come when you're driving a Mercedes down the street. That's not the only blessings you can receive. You can receive the blessing of life. And with the blessing of life comes the opportunity to share the gospel. That's a blessing. Be proud of what He's given you. He has provided and given us all we've needed. Not everything we've wanted, but everything we've needed. How do I know that? You're here. You're alive. He gives you sustenance. He may not give you the dessert, but He gives you the dinner. Right? We all want dessert, but sometimes all you get is the dinner. So, we're going to go over it again. How can you give back to God? Right? And that's a rhetorical. I need your answer. You guys already answered me. I love you guys for that. Alright? How do we give back to God? By using your gifts for God's kingdom. Your gifts. I'm not asking you to sing like Thalmon Cortez. I'm not asking you to play the guitar like Alan. I'm not asking you to do what we can do. I'm asking you to do what you can do. I'm not even asking you to get out of your comfort zone. I'm saying, what are you great at, and do it for God. That's all you got to do. I mean, that's all He expects. You can't be who you're not. So what are you good at, and do it for God. I have some people that are like, oh, I just dance. Well then, start a dancing ministry. I don't know, man. Do something great for God. He's given you blessings and blessings and blessings. And all He asks is, whatever I made you great at, just do it for me, man. Just do it for me. But sometimes it's inconvenient. Sometimes it is hard. Sometimes people will laugh at you. Sometimes people will mock you. But in my mind, I'm like, do it, bro. You're going to come around someday. You're going to see how great it is one day. You're going to see how great it is, because you're going to see how great my God is. And then from there moving forward, you're going to want to be a part one day. Don't worry about what people say. Worry about what God says. And if God says, brother, I gave you something awesome that you can do, do it in my name, do it for me, then we're going to do it. Amen? Amen. Amen. Now, moving forward, right? Again, guys, please, money's not everything. And I really stress it. I really stress it, because people are like, I gave my tithes. I don't care if you gave your tithes. That's between you and God. Amen. I don't care. That's between you, God, maybe Pastor, because Pastor's got to pay the bills. And even then, he doesn't even know who gives what. I don't care if you gave tithes. What have you given to God? Because that was, you were told to give that up. That wasn't out of the kindness of your heart a majority of the time. What have you given aside from your tithes for God? Did you give your time? Did you give your effort? Did you give your resources? Time is everything. Did you give time to God, or did you make time for God? Right? Did He get your scraps, or did you give Him your 100%? Okay? Now, again, guys, I am not asking you to step out of your comfort zone. Do great things with what God has already given you. You can stay within your comfort zone and bless so many people. The best example I can give you, right, we talk about athletes, and a lot of people are like, he can just throw and catch a ball. I'm like, you know what? But he has a pedestal in which people are willing to listen to him, and people are willing to talk to him, and people are willing to put him on the news, and guess what? Those people have the opportunity to share the gospel. And they use their platform to share. That's a perfect example. You're great at football, people love watching you play, then guess what? They're going to love hearing you also. Those are opportunities. Don't think because, well, all I do is play ball, I can't do nothing. You can do a lot of things. Each and every single one of you has an opportunity. Now, use the gifts He's given you for something greater than yourself. Let that resonate in your mind. Use something He's given you for something greater than yourself. Because it's one thing to say, well, I do it because I like it. Do something. Be a part of something that's bigger than just you. Be a part of somebody changing their lives for the better. Be a part of a community being changed to follow God's word. Be a part of something great. Don't get caught up in yourself. You can be awesome as long as God's with you. Does that make sense? Everyone understand? Remember, this is Collision Takeover. So if somebody does not understand, throw your hand up. We'll throw it in another way, okay? We're going to hit the second thing that we're going to be talking about, the second scripture. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 7. It says, whoever sows sparingly and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. And each one of us must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or not under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So let's break it down, right? Whoever sows sparingly will keep sparing. So whoever gives a little receives a little. We don't all get the same, right? What we did get the same was grace and mercy. From then on, it's on you. So those who do minimal get minimal. And those who give a lot receive a lot. And again, that's why I put a very big emphasis on money isn't everything. Not everyone has a lot of money to give, but if you got time, you got resources, you got skills, you give a lot of that, you receive a lot back. Okay? Now, each one of us must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Guys, God doesn't want your leftovers. He doesn't want what you have left over. He doesn't want what you don't want. He doesn't want your pity. He doesn't want that, oh, I'm going to give to him because I'm like, no, he wants you to give to him because you love him. He wants you to give to him because you care about him. Okay? He doesn't want your spare time. He wants you to make time. Imagine going, like, for those of you that are married, imagine going to your wife and just being like, well, I hang out with you because I have to. You'd be divorced like that, bro. Sign the papers, it's done. Or imagine going out, I guess, what's another example we can give? I know I wrote one down. Oh, or let's say my mom. My mom is a super loving person and she's very sensitive, right? She's not here, so I can talk a little bit more about her. She's at home, she stayed a little late, but she's a very sensitive person, so it's easy to hurt her feelings, right? That's like me going to my mom, and I'm like, I'm only here because I have to be. That would just obliterate her. That would obliterate like every mom in here, like, I'm just here because I have to be here, mom. So why do we do it to God? Right, you show up to her, well, it's because I have to be here, God. He's like, well, then go home, bro. I don't need that. Go home. If you don't want to be here, go. You know what I'm saying? Especially if you've been part of a church and you've seen the great things and you've seen all the crazy things that he can do and he's blessed your life and you still have that mindset, go home if you don't want to be a part. And come back when you're ready to join. Now, for the brand new believers, all right, that's a little different, right? That's a little different. You don't know the greatness yet. You haven't seen it, but I know every single person in this room has seen God do awesome, great, wonderful things. There is no reason to have that mindset of, well, I'm here because I have to be here. I'm here because they made me. I'm here out of guilt. I mean, like, there is no reason for that. If that's the case, go home. It doesn't need that mentality. The church itself, if we're building from the inside out, doesn't need that mentality. Either we're all in or we're not. Either we're all ready to fight for one another and for the word of God, or we're not. Either we believe in what we preach or we don't. But the church itself does not need more division than it already has, especially with everything going on now. Now, I'm not here to tell you guys that we're all divided and we're miserable, but I want you guys to understand there are ways to make sure that we don't get divided and we don't end up miserable. NFL time, guys. Now, I want to give you examples of what it means to give when you truly love somebody. Okay? I'm all about examples with the kids, because if you can say it, but if you don't explain to them, they're not going to get it. There's nothing to run with, right? There's no way to connect. So if people that are just start dating, they just met each other, you're going to go out of their way to buy them gifts, you're going to give them your time, you're going to stay up late to talk to them, you're going to go to the movies. Why? Because you want to be with them. Maybe you didn't have the money, so you went and worked an extra job, or you went and stayed a couple of extra hours later to make the money to take them out. Why? Because you care about them. Husbands and wives, you go out, husband or wife, because it goes either way, may work extra hours to be able to make sure that they can get their loved ones something that they love for Christmas. Why? Because you love them. Maybe you're tired, you go out of your way to make dinner, to make sure that they're happy, to make sure that they have a good day. Why? Because you love them. So why does the expectation change when it comes to God? Because the last time I checked, He gave us everything. Not half, not 75%, not 25%. He gave you everything. He continuously gives you everything, because when you mess up, He gave you a way to seek forgiveness. He gave you a way to be forgiven. So why do we keep giving God our scraps? We can't do that. If you want to be a blessed individual, if you want God to smile upon you, you want Him to bless you and your family, stop giving Him your scraps. He's not a dog. God is God. Give Him the best that you have to offer every single opportunity that you have, or don't expect anything back. Because He already gave you grace and mercy. Everything else is earned. You earn your blessings. Okay? Now, how many of you guys love Jesus? Give me an amen.
Amen.
That was miserable. Jesus, like, He died for you. How many of you guys love Jesus?
Amen.
That's a little bit better. I guess it's the morning, right? So you guys are trying your best. But I want you guys to have that conversation. We're going to have this conversation, okay? And it's a very honest conversation, and it's a very real topic. And I always tell the kids, like, when I talk to God, when I think, I need someone to punch me in the mouth. I don't need anybody to sugarcoat it, because then I won't understand it. That's just me. Things just, ask my girlfriend. She gets frustrated with me sometimes, right? Because I don't always understand everything that's going on. So when I talk to the kids, I give it to them as blunt as I can. I need them to understand. And sometimes adults are just as bad as kids. They're just big kids in grown-up bodies, right? I need you guys to understand 100%, because if I don't, then I do you a disservice. That's just, it is what it is. Okay, so we're going to have an honest conversation. When you're in need, right, you expect Him to drop everything for you. Right? When you're sick, you expect Him to heal you. When you're having a bad week, you expect Him to step in and help you out. We do. When we're sick, we pray for healing. And we're like, God, we really need it. Please, I really need the healing, because this is happening and this is happening. But if you actually sit down and think about it, how much time did you give to Him? Now, I'm not saying He won't. I'm not saying He won't heal you. I'm not saying He won't go out of His way. God is great, God is awesome, and God is merciful. But when we sit there, the honest conversation is, we always want God to drop everything for us. Always. Regardless of the situation. We always do that. We will pray and we want an answer now. God, you need to answer me now, because I don't understand, or because I'm sad, or because I'm crying, or because I'm upset. We always want God to answer now. And there's times when we sit there and we wonder why brother and sister so-and-so are so blessed, and why brother and sister so-and-so have so many blessings coming their way, and why they're so happy, and why they're so this, and why they're so that. But if you actually take the time to look into a mirror, you'll understand why you've received what you've received. Both good and bad. There are some things that you can't just blame the enemy for. Sometimes you messed up, man. You made the decision. Sometimes you chose to go the wrong way. I hate when people go out there and say, the devil did this. The devil, I'm like, dude, you still made the decision. Look in the mirror. Let's get this going. Let's get it fixed. But aside from the big things, we sit there and wonder why so-and-so is so blessed, and why so-and-so is able to get a new house and a new car, and why they're always so happy and they're always so joyful. We sit there and wonder those things, and we're like, but then I can genuinely ask, okay, well, how much time do you give to God? Because God is joy. God is happiness. God is love. God is everything that you need, and if you don't give Him that time, you're deficient. There are going to be things that you're going to be missing if you don't have God. Aside from the blessings. Aside from the great things. The basic things you will miss if you don't put God first. God should always be number one priority. To sit there and say, am I really making time for God or am I giving them my scraps? Am I only giving them the time that's convenient or am I giving him or am I making time for him? All of that makes a difference because he sees the intention in which you do things. It's one thing to go help out an individual because you want to look good, another because you want to help them. And I want you guys to understand he sees that. He acknowledges that. If you do good things for the wrong reasons, you shouldn't have done them at all. There was no point. You got nothing coming your way except for, oh good, they saw you. Oh, you're happy. Good job. But they saw you. I know why you did it. How many times do we actually look into a mirror and say, is my life this way because of things I've done or things that I haven't done? We can't blame. I mean, the devil only has as much power as you give him. We can't always blame the enemy. We can't always blame other people. We can't always throw the blame on somebody else. If you're not happy, what are you doing to change it? If you're depressed, if you're sad, if you have anxiety, if you have all these different things, what are you doing to change it? Or maybe you don't have those things. Maybe life is okay, but you just feel like you're missing something. Well, what are you doing to change it? Because not everything is doom and gloom, right? Life is like a roller coaster of emotions. Maybe you do feel great. I'm missing something. I can't find my happiness. I can't find my joy. What are you doing to change it? Are you going to the one that is literally joy, happiness, and greatness, the great I am, Alpha and Omega? Are you going to that person? Or are you still gonna wander in the desert for another 40 years until you figure it out? Right? There's only so much blame you can throw on somebody else or on something else. So we need to genuinely take a look in the mirror and say, what am I doing and what am I not doing? Am I choosing God? Am I putting Jesus first? Or am I putting him behind my job? Am I putting him behind my money, behind my fun time, God has to come first. There's a second aspect of it, right? Because we have a lot of people that come to church. Are you even serving them with a joyful heart? You can come to church and still be bitter. You can come to church for 40 years and still go to hell. What does it matter? Everything needs to be intentional. God, I'm doing this for this reason. Not just whatever. It's not whatever. Not because I'm forced to be here. Not because I have to be here. God, I'm here because I love you. I'm here because of the blessings you've given me. I'm here because of all the great things you've done for my family. Maybe it's not even for you. I'm here because God, thank you for, healing my loved one when I prayed all night. You have to. Everything with intention. Because everything that God does is intentional. Everything he does for your life is intentional. He doesn't do things for the heck of it. He doesn't do things by mistake. Every decision in your life that he's helped you with, that he's been a part of, has been intentional. You being born was intentional. Understand that. So be intentional when you do things for him. Be intentional when you come to church. Don't just come to church, sit down, listen to a few words and go home. Be intentional. Learn as much as you can. Receive as much as you can. Open your heart, listen as much as you can. And also give as much as you can. Be a part of praise and worship. Be part of the message. Don't just come because it looks good. You can't do that. God chose you first. Understand that. God chose you guys first. And every single day he continues to choose you first. The day he gave his son to die on the cross for you was the day that he gave his 125%. Because Old Testament said he had already given us laws. He had already given us rules. He had already given us regulations. And he's already given us opportunities. And when he gave his son to die on us, he gave an extra, more than 100%. And we still don't trust him. He's still behind my job. He's still behind my money. You don't have life without him. You don't got a job without him. You don't got anything without him. You don't even have a breath coming out of your mouth without him. But we want to put him last. So today, like we always do to the kids, we're going to offer you guys a challenge. A genuine challenge. I don't need you to go ask people questions. I don't need you to go learn a Bible verse. I need you to take an honest look at your life. Right now. I don't care what you did 10 years ago. How is your life right now? 10 years ago doesn't matter if your life is horrible and miserable right now. So I want you to take an honest look at your life. Maybe from here to a couple months back. Take a look at your life right now. It's not always, I want you guys to know this, it's not always about a strong start, but it's always about a strong finish. So if we're not meeting up to standard, maybe we're not making it, maybe we're not doing great right now, it's okay, we can still fix that. Like I said, it's not about a strong start, it's about a strong finish. And I'm going to ask you guys to close your eyes, bow your heads, and I encourage you to stand so you can reflect on your life. And if you haven't given God the time he deserves, the time, the resources, you, then I want you to take the time to make amends. Because to give God less than 100% is wrong. To give God less than your best is wrong. So with every head bowed, every eyes closed, I want you to take that challenge and stand if you need to make those amends. And maybe you don't need to make amends, maybe you just want to talk to God about your life. Maybe you're going through something. Maybe you're having a tough week, a tough month, a tough year. Maybe things aren't going the way that you thought they should be going. Then I ask that you stand and put God first in your life and watch him work. And we'll give you this time to yourself and with God. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for everything that you've done for us. First and foremost, we acknowledge that you are our God. That we love you to the ends of the earth and that we would do anything for you because you've done everything for us. God, today we've thrown a challenge out there to reflect on our lives and hopefully make amends with the things that we've done with you. God, the more important challenge here is the challenge offered to actually give their time, give their resource, give their talents, give their skills to be used for you, to be used to build your kingdom, to be used in your name. God, all I ask is that, first and foremost, you speak into their hearts, reach and give them the peace that they're asking for, give them the love that they need, take out the depression and fill it with joy, God. But I also ask that you give them the opportunity to share their talents, share their resources, share their time. Because God, every day is about you and every day is for you. And from this day moving forward, we choose to intentionally reach out to you, intentionally pray to you, intentionally worship you, intentionally use our talents for the greatness of your kingdom. We thank you for each and everything, every single blessing that you've given each and every family here. And I ask that you continue to bless them and continue to anoint them and continue to speak to them to change the lives of each and every single person that they come across in this world. God, now I offer this time for them to talk to you and make amends with you on whatever they may need to. We love you. Okay, so how many of you guys have had a good Sunday so far? How many received a little bit more today? How many of you are going to be intentional with God and everything that you do for Him? Amen. Amen. That's what I'm talking about, guys. So if you need a... Pastor gave me a few commercials to give to you guys. So we're going to give out two different envelopes, okay? The very first one, if you want to help be part of Project 1511, if you don't know, they sponsor kids to give them a Christmas. These are kids that, you know, at times literally don't have a roof on their house, don't have doors, don't have shoes, don't have stuff like that. If you want to be a part of that, go ahead and raise your hand. Any little small donation helps. If you want to be a part of that, we are not picking that up today. Okay, we're going to pick that up next week. Now, right now, I want you to raise your hand if you need a tithing envelope so Sister Cooking can go ahead and give that to you guys. One of the commercials that we are going to share to everybody is going to be, we are going to be having another youth night. Okay, it's going to be our youth night / Thanksgiving dinner for the youth. Okay, so please try to get the kids there. It's going to be November 12th, it's a Saturday at 5. Guys, it's a lot of work to make turkeys. So we're actually going to be using, we're going to be grilling steaks for the kids. It's for the kids, okay? So kids, if you want to bring other people, it's cool. I want you to just let me know. Okay, let me know so I make sure I have enough steak for everybody. And we're going to do all the other stuff, you know, potatoes, all the other things. So we're going to make it great. We're just going to substitute turkey for steak, all right? Aside from that, we hope you guys have a great great week on Facebook. We love you guys, and we'll see you next week, okay?